You've probably used AI to write bad code, and then had a hard time fixing it. What if it could run its own code, see that it failed, and then evolve a better version, and do that in a loop again and again? That's the principle behind two recent research papers, AlphaEvolve and Darwin Goedel Machines. In this video, we're going to look under the hood and understand the mechanism that makes self-improving code possible, and then think about what that means for building things with AI. In this presentation, I'm going to quickly go over the evolution ideas which I've presented in my previous videos, and then go for the DeepMind paper AlphaEvolve and Darwin Goedel Machines from Sakana AI and researchers from the University of British Columbia. So in previous videos, I've talked about the arrival of novelty search and open-endedness as themes within the evolution space, and also map elites as a contribution from Jeff Kloon, who is the supervisor from one of the Machine Learning Singapore speakers who came for the ICLR event in 2025. One of the key ideas here is to prevent population collapse. This occurs where individuals in a population all kind of converge on the same solution, and that prevents evolution from having its true power, since you're then reduced to just mutating around like a common individual. Whereas the true power of evolution involves mixing diverse elements from different individuals to kind of capture the power of crossover. In the last video, we saw evolution starting with LLMs, and in particular, evolving prompts with Prompt Breeder and how that was used in Self-Discover. Heading in the direction of evolving programs, DeepMind applied this idea to mathematical discovery with their fun search research. Here, we're going to look at AlphaEvolve, which is yet another iteration in a more kind of general setting. For my part, around the time AlphaEvolve came out and before Darwin Goedel Machines, I was applying this for GPU kernel scientist, which I talked about at the beginning of this kind of evolution of code series of videos. So I've got a link to the paper for AlphaEvolve here, and I'll leave it in the description too. And there's also a nice DeepMind blog post about this AlphaEvolve work. The key thing is that the AI agent is going to evolve algorithms for performing tasks. And these tasks are not just going to be mathematical, they're also going to have practical applications in computing, and in particular, applications within Google's own infrastructure. So this is going to be able to combine the creativity of LLMs with automated evaluations, since each of the tasks is going to be able to be scorable by some concrete method. So in some sense, the AlphaEvolve will come as no surprise to people who've been looking at these evolutionary methods. What we're going to do is essentially have some seed programs. We're then going to be able to generate new programs from those, or new individuals. We're going to then subject them to evaluation by essentially running the programs. And from there, we're going to add them to a database or a population of programs, and then basically repeat this loop using the evaluations as a guide to which programs are performing well and to what lines of inquiry to keep attacking. So when I talked about this at the Singapore Machine Learning Group, which was only a few days after the paper was released, I also found that there was a person based in Singapore who had created an OpenEvolve repo on GitHub, which is well-written code and definitely a nice thing to have a look at. So in terms of results, AlphaEvolve reported a wide number of applications which this thing had been applied to. Faster matrix multiplication, discovering particular objects or constructions for mathematical problems so that we can kind of prove that things are getting optimal or near optimal. They applied it to Google's own computing infrastructure, but it's interesting that the 0.7% improvement that it gave kind of showed that Google engineers did an excellent job before this mechanical evolution started to try and optimize beyond them. It also optimized some of the tiling strategy for coordinating computation for training Gemini itself. So while they claimed that there were 23% kernel speedups, I suspect this was only a small part of the process because there was overall only a 1% reduction in Gemini's overall training times. So maybe this is for select kernels, or maybe there's a factor which is dominating these training times beyond just, you know, these kernels. And as soon as the compute gets faster than this overriding like headline, then improvements in this computer is not going to help until you can bring that headline factor down as well. So one of the questions in my mind when I saw the mating matrix multiply faster is, what exactly are they doing? So I'm quite familiar with how GPUs might do this faster, but that's a question of caching and organizing the computations in a parallel way. But this seemed to be like a fundamental mathematical thing, and it seems on its face that if I want to multiply these 2x2 matrices together, I'm going to have to compute, you know, AE plus BG and AF plus BH. And that's going to involve 8 multiplies in here. I've got 4 additions and 8 multiplies to get these results. It seems kind of irreducible that you can do this faster. So in fact, this reduction in multiplies comes from not doing this in a very GPU-like way, but by noticing some clever factorizations. And this Strassen's method was devised well before any of this modern computation, whereby they noticed that if you compute these separate little factors here, so the A times F minus H and the C plus D times E, I need only 7 of these, and I can then, just by adding and subtracting them, come up with the true answer to this matrix multiply. So while the number of multiplies has decreased, I'm doing a lot more operations and also carefully orchestrating them so that I get the right result in the end. So AlphaEvolve is doing this with larger matrices, and in particular they focus on this kind of scalable approach which can be nested, but that's not to say that this can be applied to GPU processing of matrices. In particular, the GPUs love doing things in a very regimented, orderly way, all the things the same. This is definitely not coming out as suggesting an easy approach using a GPU just by removing a few multiplies here. So one of the factors that allows this all to work is we're getting better large language models. With these new LLMs, we can both write and change programs much more reliably. Though with AlphaEvolve, we also have this evaluation step, which basically allows us to reject bad changes automatically. So that's kind of a key part of this to keep the reliability up. We can also use the LLMs to compare outcomes. So basically you can ask the question, why did this work? Why didn't this work? And LLMs will come up with at least a reasonable sounding answer. We can also use LLMs to combine instructions for LLMs, as we saw previously with Prompt Breeder. And furthermore, one of the other things that research has shown is that these LLMs have acquired a human notion of elegance and novelty so that they can judge whether programs are elegant or are clear. This is something which is kind of surprising. This taste aspect is somewhat surprising, since in many ways you think of the LLMs learning how to type strokes on a keyboard as being the low-level task. But equally, LLMs have read all books on management, all books on taste. So in some sense, they view all of these different levels of tasks as being somewhat equivalent, whereas from a human perspective, there seems to be a hierarchy of tasks that if you can't do typing the code, you could never judge the code. But LLMs aren't learning in the same way as humans do from the bottom up. They're learning very broadly all at once. So the next question could be, how do we use evolution everywhere? As we saw from Prompt Breeder, not only can you essentially mutate a prompt until it gets very good at a task, so that's one level of mutation, but you can also specify how does the mutation operator work and breed that itself. So there's like a meta level of mutation going on. Can we use evolution effects on how these processes go about evolving the processes? So now let's have a look at Darwin Goedel machines. This DGM research is from researchers at University of British Columbia and also Sakana AI, which is based in Tokyo and has rather a different take on research directions than the major research labs. In fact, I might also point out that DGM is an anagram of GDM, which is a Google DeepMind. I'm wondering whether this is a deliberate poke at some of their prior colleagues. So Darwin Goedel machines contains 2 key ideas. One from the Goedel side and one from the Darwinian side. So on the Goedel side, we're going to have a program which can rewrite its own code. And on the Darwinian side, we're going to have a family tree of these code examples, essentially being driven by how well they perform on the task. So Gödel was a famous mathematician, and this work's name draws heavily from the work by Schmidhuber in 2003, where he also talked about Gödel machines. One of the key differences, though, is that a true Gödel machine only improves itself in provably mathematically correct steps, whereas here we're just going to let an LLM write new code to improve itself and then test it to see whether it works. Ironically, Gödel is probably best known for his theorem, the incompleteness theorem, which essentially proves that mathematics cannot describe itself in a fully consistent way and be large enough to describe all the things you might want to. So this actually, I think it's in the 1930s, put a fundamental limit on the extent to which mathematics can understand itself. So Gödel is an interesting character. Darwin needs no introduction in terms of evolution, and here is a quote which is essentially stating the equivalence of fitness and survival, so essentially a definitional quote. So the key component of Darwin Goedel machines are these coding agents on the left-hand side, and each coding agent has the ability to approach a task by writing code which completes the task. So there's kind of a multi-level thing going on there. And there's also the ability to change that agent so that its behavior when writing the code may be different. So this kind of higher level optimization is taking place as well. At each step, we're going to measure how good it is at the actual task to enable us to have some kind of fitness measure. And then once we have a fitness, we can then track out a family tree of all of these different agents and how they perform on the task. So you can see here, from the top, we start out with a single agent which has multiple offspring. Some of them just don't work out. It may be that they don't even write code which runs, but some of them have some other level of performance. And basically, the Darwin Goedel machine algorithm goes through these agents trying to balance out where it's going to find success by having successive offspring of offspring and so on. So we see here that we've got a branching process which actually leads to a very good outcome, which is actually slightly shallower depth than some of the other things which it evaluated, which on this lobe it would have decided it wasn't getting anywhere, whereas we'd actually got to a very strong path through this line in the family tree. So they do a nice graph of the performance steps. You can see here that this blue line is kind of where the current high watermark in terms of performance is. But if we look at the lineage of what the best performing eventual outcome would be, it shows that its parents weren't only the very best which came out. It was this one also happened to be the best, and so did this one, and so did this one. But along the way, there were step backs in performance in order to get to a better level. So this shows that the benefits of having a diverse array of potential individuals that you're looking at, because if you just focus on using the best one to get to the next generation, you're missing out a lot of details along the way. Sometimes you have to take a step backwards in order to take two steps forwards. Also on this diagram are kind of some of the key innovations that went through, which have been identified either by looking at them or by asking an LLM for what happened here. I'm not sure. One slightly troubling thing in the paper is they redefine the term sui bench to mean sui bench verified subset. So all their graphs, which are labeled sui bench, are actually sui bench verified scores. This is saving some characters, but that leads excerpts from the paper to be overclaims when people quote them. Something similar happened with the Sakana paper looking at ARC AGI, when in fact they allowed very many more samples than was technically allowed in the actual benchmark. It's not a good look. So as a quick wrap-up for Darwin Goedel machines, this is kind of taking the self-improvement at a meta level up from AlphaEvolve, which is kind of nice to see. The code repo also contains all of the prompts, and they also notably didn't use an agent framework. They hand-coded this in Python, which is in a way nice to see how this is explicitly done. And it also means this is going to be more reproducible in the future. I should also mention a nice talk by Andre Karpathy at the AI Startup School from Y Combinator, where he talked about the different software levels. So in his software version system, software 1.0 is where humans code up how to do the task. This applied up to, say, 2010-2012. Software 2.0 is when neural networks came along, and instead of humans essentially handcrafting if-then statements to match the data, we just get neural networks to fit the data as well as possible. So this has been a grand scheme for more than a decade. Software 3.0 is where the computer is now writing the code, which is learnt to do from data, but now can write code which can be adapted to many, many tasks. And putting this in a nice loop enables you to write verifiable code. You can also think of going beyond this, where the computer creates the computer that writes the code. And kind of this is where we start moving off into deep think territory. Super interesting line of inquiry. So to wrap up, what we've seen here and throughout this whole mini-series on evolution is that everything old is now new again. These evolutionary methods, which stem from work done in the 90s, are now coming to flourish in the era of LLMs. These LLMs can now power these larger systems, and that gives them surprising capabilities in terms of how their flexibility can be applied to evolution itself. One interesting thing is that, experimentally speaking, this is very early days in designing these kind of systems. Clearly, the LLM field is very mature in terms of the big proprietary labs. On the other hand, the GDM work can be constructed using pure Python, and it doesn't need anything but calls to some of these big models. So it's very early days in terms of understanding what can be achieved with these systems, and we can all participate in that. Thanks for watching this video. I'd love to read comments if you have them, and in particular, if you have ideas for new videos, I'd be super happy to address those. Cheers.